Well, it doesn't look like it looks pretty good.
No more.
Welcome to the Branch. It's good to see everybody here this rainy morning. It's a good rain, though, right? It's life-giving rain that we're getting, so praise God for that. If you guys are able, would you stand with us? We're going to sing a couple more songs of praise and worship to our God in heaven. Paul, in the book of Ephesians, he wrote in chapter 1, he was talking about the church there, about having their eyes opened to what the Lord was doing in their lives. And so it's always our hope and our prayer here is that we can have the open eyes, the open ears, and the open heart so that we can just decipher and just hear and meditate on God's word. So come on, let's sing. They're pretty quick songs. You can put your hands together if you choose.
You unravel me, melody. You surround me with a song of deliverance. Thank you.
All right. Hey, everybody. You can continue this fun fellowship time downstairs when we have refreshments. I'm inviting everyone down after the service for coffee and tea and hopefully some goodies. I am Amy Peters, and I welcome you to the branch. Hi, good morning, everybody. It's good to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Thank you, Jesus. Let's see. Today is the day the Lord has made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Oh, my goodness. It may be cloudy outside with chance of rain, but in here, the S-O-N is shining in each and every one of you, and I can see the Spirit of God in your faces, truly. Boy, do I miss you. I really do miss you all, and even my new friends I've just met today for the first time. I'm glad to make your acquaintance. All right, I do have some announcements, but all of you, I bet, can read at a third grade reading level or more. So, therefore, I'm only going to... What's it there for? Okay. I just want you to know that this Thursday is National Day of Prayer. Our sanctuary downstairs will be open, the glass doors on the street, if you want to pop in for your lunch time and pray for our nation. And I have good news for you. Somebody that's dead, that lived in 55 BC, wrote The Conditions of Rome. I wish I had brought them with me. And everything that is happening in our nation has happened back in 55 BC. So nothing's changed for 2,071 years here. And the world is going to still keep spinning around. And God is going to take care of us. And God is going to provide for us. Amen and hallelujah. Amen. All right? But do your civic duty and vote. Amen. Boy, I can't believe I'm talking politics here. I never, ever do that. But I know that times are very tough for our fellow humankind, and we need to be reaching out in love and compassion and helping to give a hand up to those who need it during these trying times. Also going on this week, is there anything else going on this week that I need to mention here? Let me look back here real quick. Grief shares this afternoon, which is always good. I would like to extend Christian sympathy to two people in our church family that worship downstairs. I don't know if you know the Woods family, but Harvey Woods has lost his wife. Actually, she graduated to heaven, so she's not lost. But she has passed away to eternal glory. And that viewing is tonight at Chandler, if any of you know the Woods, from 3 to 5. And the funeral tomorrow is at Chandler's at 10:30. And another family downstairs, Lynn Armstrong, has lost her dad, Bob Dunnigan. And that funeral is on Friday here at Atonement at 10:30. So Sue Anderson, you lost your sister. I'm so sorry. We extend Christian sympathy to you, Sue. We will keep you in prayers, okay? 59. Oh, Sue, I'm so sorry. I pray the God of all comfort will meet your every need in Jesus this week, Sue, as you say goodbye. And please cry. I've been crying over Mr. Dunnigan dying because he has a little history with me, and I'm really missing him. All right. Now, at this time, we're going to have a time of showing and responding to God's greatness and glory in our lives by receiving an offering. And I'm thinking that God's blessed you this past week. Could that be right? Correct? So we want to give back something to God to help us continue to connect the Claymont community and beyond to Christ, to Jesus Christ. That is our vision statement here and has been since about 2008, to connect the Claymont community and beyond to Jesus Christ. And I think we're doing a pretty good job here at Atonement Church, aren't we? So, yay God, hallelujah, and thank you, Jesus. Thank you, God. Let us pray. Great and almighty God, creator of all this universe, you are God. You're all powerful, all knowing, you're ever present. You are a super awesome God, worthy of our praise and honor. Lord God, you are holy, and we have just sung your praises here at the Branch, Lord God, for who you are. And Father, we do want to show our love back to you. You have asked for us to give a portion back, and you have blessed us, O God, in so many ways, with time, with life, with money, food, clothing, housing, and 10,000 blessings beside, O God. So receive this offering, Lord God, in the name of Jesus, and multiply it, Father God, that we can continue to do ministry and bring glory and honor to you, our personal Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, precious Holy Spirit, and Father in heaven. For we ask all this in Jesus' name, and let the church say amen.
All the scripture comes from the Gospel of John. I am the true vine, and my Father is the garden. He cuts off every branch in me that bears no fruit, while every branch that does bear fruit he prunes, so that it will be even more fruitful. You are already clean because of the word I have spoken to you. Remain in me, as I also remain in you. No branch can bear fruit by itself. It must remain in the vine. Neither can you bear fruit unless you remain in me. I am the vine, you are the branches. If you remain in me and I in you, you will bear much fruit. Apart from me, you can do nothing. If you do not remain in me, you are like a branch that is thrown away and withers. Such branches are picked up, thrown into the fire and burned. If you remain in me and my words remain in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. This is my Father's glory, that you bear much fruit, showing yourselves to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so I have loved you. Now remain in my love. If you keep my commands, you will remain in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commands and remain in his love. I have told you this so that my joy may be in you and that your joy may be complete. My command is this: love each other as I have loved you. Greater love has no one than this, to lay down one's life for one's friend. You are my friends if you do what I command. I no longer call you servants, because a servant does not know his master's business. Instead, I have called you friends, for everything that I have learned from my Father, I have made known to you. You did not choose me, but I chose you and appointed you so that you might go and bear fruit that will last. And so that whatever you ask in my name, the Father will give you. This is my command: love each other. This is God's word for God's people.
Thanks be to God.
Spiritual discernment is really the way God allows us to see the world, see ourselves through his eyes. And so God gives us that privilege. He gives us the Bible as a lens to see the world the way he sees us. It's an amazing thing. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, we're enabled to understand the Bible, to understand the scripture, and through it, to understand the world, the way the world really works. And that's really what discernment is. It's using the tools God has given us to see things in his way so we can live lives that honor God. And so every Christian needs to be discerning. And it's interesting, when you look into spiritual discernment in the Bible, it's always connected to spiritual maturity. So if you want to be a discerning Christian, you need to be a mature Christian, one who's growing in his faith, one who's understanding the Bible, one who's growing in his knowledge of the Lord. And so do you want to be discerning? Be mature. Just grow up as a Christian. Find Christians that you love and Christians who are mature and ask them, how can I be a growing, mature, faithful Christian? And as you grow in maturity, you'll also grow in discernment and your ability to distinguish between what's right and wrong, what's good and what's evil. And living in the world we do today, where there's so many messages pouring into our ears, into our minds from so many different places across the internet, through TV, radio, whatever it is, I think we need to be very discerning. We need to understand that Satan is very actively opposed to us, very active in his opposition to the Christian message, to the gospel. So grow up as a Christian. You'll also find as you grow up that you become more discerning and you'll be able to understand how God wants us to live in this world in a way that honors him.
That's good stuff, isn't it? To set the stage here. I just want to say a shout out to our social media friends. In particular, we have someone from Hope that's recuperating from a fall on his bicycle, Bill Sexton, our guitar player. And he is getting better, but he's had to stay home off of his leg. And he also could use our prayers. But Bill, we're thinking of you. And everyone else that's out there that is, listening. And did Pastor John tell you that we have like 50 different countries around the world that have listened to us on the internet? That's pretty cool beans too. All kinds of good stuff at Atonement Church. So I've been asked to have a couple words of prayer here for people. So we're going to take a minute and we're going to unite our hearts together. Amen. And we're all in agreement that the Spirit will just lead me in this prayer, because, my friends, it's all about the Holy Spirit in my life. I could not even begin to know how to pray for the things I've been asked to pray for over the past 6 years. And God gives me the words, and thanks be to God. Let us pray. Father, together we are in agreement, all my brothers and sisters in Christ here at the branch. And first of all, God, we thank you for this family. And I heard twice already today, this is a family. And Harry feels it's a family. They've prayed him back to health and wholeness, Lord. He's worshiping here with us today after really going through a dark night of the soul, Lord. What he went through in the hospital, a long recovery, Harry. And praise be to God, your wonderful God, that heard and answered your prayers for your healing. And we do pray prayers of comfort. And Lord, just, Father God, the freedom to be who they are as they have said goodbye to the precious family members here, in particular Sue Anderson, Father, and the loss of her beloved sister, Lord. We know that even the wisest man on earth, King Solomon, said there's a time to weep, a time to cry. And Lord God, we know that one day you will turn our weeping into joy. But for now, let Sue be real and let her be real in how she's feeling, Lord God. And let, I pray, God, that you be real to her, Lord God. And let her know in any way, shape, or form, Lord, that you are with her, that you see her heart, you count her tears, and you love her so very much. And finally, I pray for Sarah. Sarah DiBerardina, sitting right down here in the front, Lord, has such a passion for you, Lord God Almighty. And she has a passion for her family. And her son, Scott, has been sick for a very long time, Lord. And he needs 24-hour care in her home, Lord. And it's her and her husband that are serving him, Lord, in your name and meeting his needs, Father God. And Father, she needs assurance, Lord, that she can do this. So we're praying helping prayers on Sarah, Father, for you to just give her the strength, Lord, that she needs. And Father, the joy to know that even giving a cup of cold water to this young man, that she is giving it to you, Lord Jesus. So Father, every little deed of love, we just ask you to multiply it in her soul, Lord, and in her the spirit, her spirit body, Father God, to strengthen her with inner strength, that she will be amazed and she will give you the glory, knowing it's from you. For we ask this in Jesus' precious name. Amen. Amen. So we're in the great 50 days. And 1 year ago, I learned about the great 50 days, which I had never heard of before, and I actually had a message on it up here at the branch. The great 50 days that started the day Jesus rose from the dead. They call it Easter, but I call it Resurrection Sunday. And we are now in the great 50 days. 37 of them have gone by. Are you still celebrating the resurrection power? Do you still have that joy from Easter that keeps you waking up every day and singing the Lord's praises and being a thankful disciple of Jesus Christ? Nod your head if you still got that joy. Now look, I know some of you may have forgotten. Some of you are busy with life. Some of you may be like me where, you know, there just aren't enough hours in the day sometimes to do what I feel I have to do. But regardless, the good news is you still have 13 more to go. And we end on Pentecost. And that is another super amazing and incredible celebration in the church, because for the first time, the Holy Spirit fell on everyone that was a believer, not just on some for a certain time, for a certain job like the Old Testament, but the Holy Spirit. Boy, we are going to kick it up a notch at Hope Community Church. I'm sorry I'm not going to be here on Pentecost, because it is one of the greatest days in the life of the church, because it is the church's birthday. So bring cupcakes, bring candles, but don't light them all at once, right? If they don't blow out. We're just only kidding here to make my friends laugh in the front row. I found out in my studies this time on the Great 50 Days that it was to be celebrated as one single feast or celebration as the Great Lord's Day. One single feast as the great Lord's Day. So here's what I'm thinking. 50 Sundays in a row. Isn't the Sunday not the Lord's Day? The day of rest and the day of praise and worship and giving it to God. Well, that's like having 50 of them right in a row. I totally could handle 50 Sundays in a row. So you have 13 left. And I want to ask you, what are you going to do with those 13? God wants us to be people of Easter joy. And it says in the Bible, in the Amplified Bible, and what Steve just read, Steve, I was like looking for Len. I go, Len, you're forgetting the Bible reading. And then I remember it's you doing the Bible reading now. This young man's in training down here. So we are praising God for multiplying. So from the Amplified Bible, John chapter 15, verse 11 says, I, Jesus, have told you these things that my joy and my delight may be in you, and that your joy and gladness may be of full measure and complete and overflowing. And in my Bible, I wrote, thank you, Jesus, for abundant joy, heavenly joy. But my friends, today was one of those days when I came into this church this morning and I just really was not feeling the joy. But I don't have to base what I believe on my feelings. I can base it on what I know is the truth. And the truth is, I have the joy, joy, joy down in my heart. Okay? And it might, I think it was apparent I wasn't feeling myself this morning. But you know what? Being up here, I can just feel the joy bubbling up and growing. You know, there's just having two worship services in one day does the soul a lot of good. And so, this video that that you just saw on spiritual discernment was chosen for a reason. And the reason is because it encourages us and reinforces our need to grow as faithful disciples of Jesus Christ. What person wouldn't want their little infant to grow up healthy? Or the vegetables in their garden to grow up and produce good fruit? Growth is natural. Growth is a good thing. And the same applies to us. And one of the benefits, according to the video, is that we would have a sensitivity to God that's called discernment. That we can see the world through God's eyes. Isn't that very cool? I would rather see the world through God's eyes than my own eyes or someone else's eyes. But you know what? It is the desire of my heart for us to be healthy, faithful disciples here at Atonement Church. And that takes some intentional steps in order for that to happen. And you still have 13 days until Pentecost to be working on those steps. I'm not going to let you off the hook. It's an everyday challenge for us to be disciples of Jesus Christ. We have a world out there, and the film said we have a devil out there that is doing his darndest to keep us from growing and to keep me discouraged and to keep me in fear and to keep me in doubt. And I say, no way. Faith and perfect love cast out all fear. Amen. So, in case you hadn't noticed that it was the great 50 days, I have another way of putting this, and that is that spring is also part of the great 50 days. And it is all of God's beauty and splendor and magnificence and order and creativity that is just shouting out, woo, I'm here, I'm real, you can believe in me, you can trust in me. God created all of this in 6 days. And on the seventh day, he rested. And he told us to follow that example, to rest as well, and to set aside time to be with God, to worship God. Easter may seem like a long time ago, but spring is still here. And I've got spring in my heart, and spring is still in the air. The dogwoods are out. Aren't they gorgeous? The azaleas. Beautiful, my lilac bush in my backyard. I still see tulips and other spring flowers and bushes with spring blossoms. And I just feel like there are thousands, all those thousands of blossoms and blooms are a reminder of God's great joy and delight in us Because out of all of that, guess what? We're even more beautiful than his creation. We are so, so special to God, so unique, so wonderful, a masterpiece, as the book of Ephesians says. I know that God is delighting in me. And the music here today, just every word, it seemed like, nailed what our message was this morning. Along with spring comes weeds. So I've been doing some weeding. And I have told you before, I like to weed. And here's why. It's solitude. It's silent. Other than the beautiful songs of the birds. I wish I could help on the green team. I just can't fit one more thing in my schedule, though. Okay? But I thank you for doing and serving the Lord with keeping our church looking so beautiful. So, I've also been weeding and gardening at the little community that is like less than a half a mile away from us called Knollwood. Knollwood is our mission field. We have adopted Knollwood, and we really want to be a blessing to Knollwood. I got to do a funeral last year for a woman who lived in Knollwood. Thank you very much to my friend right here. She said her neighbor was elderly and was like a mom to her. And would I come up, would I visit this woman who was in the hospital at the time? And that is really, for the first time in my life, I went to Knollwood and discovered they're just ordinary people living there. I mean, they have that neighborhood has had a bad reputation for a long time. But I saw people as people, and we, Pastor John and I, went over to the community center after our friend graduated to heaven, and we talked to Miss Shirley, who runs the Knollwood Community Center, and we've had a relationship with her ever since. And I noticed last summer that she had six beautiful garden boxes that Archmere Academy built with her, and had like six boxes of weeds that were this high. And I thought, oh my gosh, that looks terrible. And I said, I'm going to plant something in those boxes. And so I've been doing the Bible study on Mondays from 4:15 to 5:15 with the children in the after-school program. We have weeded the boxes. We have tilled the soil, and they love getting their hands dirty. Oh my goodness, they love playing in the dirt. And they added big bags of fresh soil from bags, and we mixed it all up, and we planted marigolds around the corner, so when we plant our vegetables and our other flowers, the bunnies won't come eat them. These kids, you would think they died and gone to heaven. They are having the time of their life. They've never planted seeds. They've never got their hands dirty with soil, a potting soil. And with, we have just had the absolute best time up there. And the reason I'm telling you this is because of what God is doing, just because I wanted to pull the weeds out of the Knollwood boxes. And I invite you to get involved with Knollwood. You can volunteer with me on Mondays. And we're going to do Vacation Bible School up there. That's in your bulletin. And we want to do a community day in the fall again. And Miss Shirley, the director, came to Hope Church for the first time. And I don't think she worships anywhere else. So we're building a bridge to this wonderful community of people that are just like us. And this all ties together with our April series on the parable of the four soils. Remember us talking about that? I'm going to give you a little recap real quick. There's four kinds of soils, and we compared the soils to the soil of our heart, where the first one's so hard, your heart's so hard, that the seed, the word of God, cannot penetrate it. Okay, it's not impossible, but it's very hard. Your heart is very hard, and you don't want anything to do with the word of God. Second was where it goes into shallow soil, and there's rocks and stones in it. And there's not enough good soil there for the word of God to grow in. And the third kind was the thorns, oh my gosh, and weeds. And they just, that's of the world. The weeds of the world just choke out God's word. The TV chokes it out. The computer chokes it out. The phone chokes it out. You know, pleasure, life, and ease, and comfort, and all these distractions, just like that video said. You know, we have to be really intentional about having fertile soil so that God's word can get in there and really grow and be healthy and mature and even have good fruit in it. So, from that, I've still been thinking about it. And that's why we're talking about the vine and the branches today, because it all makes one great big picture about God's garden, your life. Your life is like a garden. Your heart is like a garden. And the most incredible, important part of your garden is to have this. This makes all the difference in your maturity. And immature Christians are baby Christians. We're not going to get into that because I don't have time to compare the two, but did the parable of the soils change anything about you? It's been just shy of 37 days. The month of April was 30 days. You had 30 days of teaching on the parable of the soils. So I asked my husband that question last night, and he didn't say anything. I said, he has his God time, but I think there should be more. I think that there has to be where it's not just in a little piece of pie. It's not just like every morning at 6 o'clock till 6:15. It's just incorporating God into everything like we do with the soil when we're mixing good soil with bad soil to get good soil. It's a way of life. And this is a way of life. Knowing the Word, living the Word, honoring the Word, memorizing the Word, telling the Word. And what did the gentleman say? Hang out with some mature Christians. You might be the mature Christian that needs to hang out with some baby Christians. I just wish you would not stop thinking about this, about the parable of the soils. And I want to tell you why. Because I've been teaching a class at Elkton United Methodist Church for the last 4 weeks. I have 14 students in that class. And I cannot tell you, they are so hungry and thirsty for the things of God. We have a book that I told them, I don't even know what some of the words are in the book. I said, just skip the words you don't know. Because I tried looking them up, and it was like taking too much time. And I know that they're taking this class. I give them homework every week to read probably 30 to 40 pages, and they are doing it. They come back, and they say, Pastor Amy, please just tell us what the book means. Put it in simple terms. Teach us how to understand this, to live it, because the name of the book is Living Our Beliefs. And that's just what I'm trying to do here. If you've learned about the parable of the soils and how important the seed, the Word of God, is to a heart that is receptive, it is going to change your life. It is going to change how you regard the Word of God in your life. If I learned anything from the parable of the soils, it's the seriousness of God's word in my life. And even when I have to walk out the back door and say, God, I'm going to the hospital, pray for this person at 5:30 a.m., my God time's out the door, there's this little impression in my mind that said, Amy, it's not what you do, it's what I've done. It's not who you are. It's not about you. It's about me. And all throughout the day, I feel that I can have a closer relationship because I just confessed to God that I couldn't keep my prayer time, but I wanted to keep it, and he's looking at our hearts, isn't he? And he is honoring what's in our heart, and I end up still having a great day, even though I didn't get to spend my God time as I like to, because I'm a true Methodist and I like to methodically do things in order, and like my God is a God of order. But I let go and I let God be God. Amen. And those people at Elkton, they want to know the truth. Do you want to know the truth? Do you really want to know the truth? Well, someone said amen when this simple passage was read to you, 17 verses. Was there anything you did not understand in here? No, because God's word speaks for itself. Jesus says, I am the great I am is speaking. I'm going to listen. I am the vine and you are the branches. The disciples, he's talking to his faithful followers, just like you and me. Yay? Yay, God! Yes, amen! We're faithful followers. We're faithful disciples. And he goes on to say that God, Almighty God, is the gardener. That makes us in God's garden. When I was studying for this message, it says, find a big branch that's kind of drying up. So when we were planting flowers at Knollwood, Jay-Z climbed up into the tree right there, and he goes, uh-oh, and down comes a branch. I said, no problem. I needed a branch, and this is a branch. So I just brought it because I don't want us to be withering away. And the way we don't wither away is to stay connected to the root, to the trunk, to the source of who we are as faithful disciples, and that's Jesus Christ. Amen and amen indeed. All right, you guys, my notes are not doing me any good here. This is I know what the Lord wants to say here. And the Lord wants me to say, we need to live closely, abide, dwell, be in an intimate, personal relationship with Jesus. If any of you first-time visitors do not know Jesus as a personal friend of yours, like we sang, please talk to me afterwards. God's love is for everyone, and today is the day of salvation. And this will change your life forever. And it keeps changing. It never stays the same if you're growing. And I have a coach now. I had to get a coach as a pastor for Hope. And she's doing some weeding in my garden. And she's doing some pruning in my world. And God wants to prune you. Even if you're a really healthy bush, don't you sometimes have to prune it back a little bit, even though it's healthy? And then it even gets better and bigger and more beautiful. So I'm not afraid to be pruned. It hurts. Gets me down sometimes, but my friends, this is the message of the vine and the branches. So maybe some of you aren't getting this whole agricultural thing. So there's another way to think of it. And the other way is, it pertains to women. But when I was asking the Lord, what, God, how can I make this today modern? And I got the image of a mother with a baby in her belly. And the absolutely unique connection of life between the cord from the mother and the cord to the baby. You're going to love this video. It's only about a minute long.
Nothing is more precious than a newborn baby, and perhaps no greater wonder exists than a human life growing within another human life. A baby thrives in a total water world for 9 months, which is utterly impossible for any person to live in immediately after they take their first breath. A baby in the womb has blood vessels with a different arrangement and structure than an adult's. This helps him get enough oxygen to grow. The baby also produces hormones that cause the mother's body to meet the baby's specific needs. The placenta, a temporary organ, takes nutrients from the mom's bloodstream in such a way that the baby's needs are met first. And in the last weeks of pregnancy, the baby releases even more hormones to tell the mom's body he is ready to be born. Mother and baby are deeply connected, yet two very separate beings in an all-or-nothing reproductive system. A step-by-step evolutionary process couldn't lead to something so complex. God put these special features in place so that we could not only survive, but thrive. The psalmist declares, "For you formed my inward parts. You covered me in my mother's womb. I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made."
Woohoo! Yay, isn't that awesome? Yay, God! Does anything exist more closely than a baby and the mother? And the baby's presence is you're just always aware of it, not at first, but the kicking and the pushing and the bumping. You just know that life is inside of you. It's the kind of closeness that Jesus is talking about in this parable. And the love that exists between, most often, a baby and a mother, it's totally unique and priceless. And that kind of love and closeness is the same kind that Jesus is talking about when he talks about the vine and the branches. And I believe we can feel that closeness. I believe we can feel that presence of God. I believe we can experience that love of God as well. Even in the worst of times, the times of crying, the times of saying goodbye to dear loved ones, the times of sacrificing. And Jesus is calling us in this passage to lay down our life, for to be willing to lay down our life. That's what I call lay down your life on the cross kind of love, where you go the extra mile, where you do more than you think that, oh, I'm already doing enough. I've done enough even. You hear that in the church. Well, I've paid my dues. I've done my share. My friends, there's so much more. There's so much more love. There's so much more for us to experience in this church and in the church that is called the Universal Church, the church that's around the world. We never want to lose our first love for the Lord. The church in Ephesus in Revelation, it talked about that church, and it said that that church got, this is right from the book of Revelation, chapter 2, verse 2. And the angel of the church of Ephesus wrote this: I know your works, your labor, your patience, and you cannot bear those who are evil. And you have tested those who say they are apostles and they are not, and you have found them to be liars. And you have persevered, and you have patience, and you have labored for my name's sake and have not become weary. Nevertheless, I have this against you, Church of Ephesus, that you have left your first love. May it never, ever be said of Atonement that we have lost our first love for God, for Jesus Christ, and for the Holy Spirit, our three one God. And that first love came to us by God's great grace that called us into a relationship, called us to a place to recognize that Jesus is Lord. And I pray and hope that today you will think long and hard about your next 13 days of the great 50 days, and that you will do something even more than you are already doing to grow and mature in your understanding of this precious book. For I ask it in Jesus' name. Let us pray. Father God, thank you that you love us so immeasurably, infinitely, unconditionally, gracefully, mercifully. God, thank you for your great love, Lord God. Thank you for your great love shown to us in Jesus Christ our Lord. And Lord, thank you for Jesus, Lord, thank you for your obedience unto death, that you would die on that cross for our sins and then do what no other faith can boast, that you arose from the dead. And you showed yourself to over 500 people before you ascended back to your heavenly throne in glory. Lord God, we are on our way to glory land, and we want to take as many with us as possible. Lord God, mature us, O God. Increase our love for each other, our love for you. And Lord God, make us hunger and thirst for right living, obedience to your commands. First to love, Lord God. And all things will be added to that as we see evil overcome with love, as we see light brought into darkness, and as we ourselves feel stronger and more empowered, Father God, to live as a faithful disciple of Jesus Christ until we meet him face to face. I pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, as Amy has already preached, 2 weeks ago, we're at Pentecost. I hope to pray that everyone comes back. Everyone brings someone with you so they experience the burden of the church here on earth. Amen.
Amen.
Go and go from this place to know that you are loved and you are wanted and you are needed. Right out those doors and down the steps is our church. Go just praising God. Day and night. Amen, church.
Amen. Amen.
To fly.